Prospect Devon Foster is on the program today. And you know, when it's this background, you don't have my records and everything back there, that means there's a guest in studio, quarterback guru and owner of the best energy in the entire business. Yogi Roth is here. We're going to break down Caleb Williams on the field, off the field, the whole nine. What are the Bears getting? What are the Commanders maybe that they should trade up and get? I know Chicago fans hate hearing that, but it could happen. He called J.J. McCarthy and Caleb, having the careers that they've had so far long ago. He knows them inside and out. And I'm talking a little bit about the Patriots post-Belichick era right now. Let's go. Having Yogi Roth in studio is just the best idea. He's an energy giver, he does not taketh, and he also has so much knowledge. And he always hits the human side of these players. And I think that's strangely, and should not be, but is a big part of what this draft class is about, with Caleb Williams and him not even being able to enjoy a basketball game without people ripping him to shreds about whatever the heck they think that means or doesn't mean or should mean or whatever. So it's such a mess. So I can't wait to talk to Yogi about that. Of course, J.J. McCarthy, maybe we'll talk a little NFL too. I mean, I want to ask him about the Justin Herberts of the world. I want to ask him about quarterbacks, the Sam Darnolds getting a chance, like Kyle Rudolph said, to operate under Kevin O'Connell up there in Minnesota. What does he make of them, their situations? It's exciting. We've got the Derby coming up, of course. NFL Draft is like a month away, which is amazing. And we've got the tourney going on as well. So lots of fun things. Darius Butler's on the show tomorrow. Deshaun Jackson's on the show tomorrow. But I want to start and get to something that Hamilton and I were texting each other over the weekend. And it's really what's going on with the Patriots in New England. Fascinating, of course. Quiet also in the first offseason post-Belichick. And I want to see who they are. What are you made of? What's your identity? What are the next steps going to be? And it's relatively unclear with how free agency has at least played out so far. They trade away Mac Jones. Here's the moves. Let's get you up to speed out there while you're drinking your coffee this morning. They bring in Jacoby Brissett. They put the transition tag on Kyle Duggar to keep him around. Not a lot of big moves here. No blockbusters here. They were in on Calvin Ridley. We heard that. That did not work out. Patriots are sitting here now with $47 million in cap space. What are you doing with that? You know? What are you doing with that? Are you swimming in those coins? What are you doing, the backflips, the backstroke? What's going on? That's the most in the NFL. No one has more to spend. And there's no big names left to sign. What are we doing? New head coach, big fan of course, you guys knew that, Gerard Mayo. He talked, we got to hear him speak as a head coach at the annual league meeting. He had to address the lack of free agent spending, telling fans the team was going to, burn some cash in free agency a couple months ago. Those were his words. We're going to burn some cash. Okay, well, you didn't. So they got some top talent targeted, and they didn't get those guys. And then I'm sure they didn't want to overspend after that. So disappointing, I think, for some fans who wanted to burn that cash, wanted to spend some money. And I don't know, probably a smart move long term to not overspend on secondary guys. So he also addressed the number 3 overall pick and what's going on there. Take a listen to Gerard here. I'll let him take it away so I can stop blabbering.
We sit at a very enviable spot at number 3, where we could take someone at 3, or if someone offers a bag, as we would say, a lot of first round picks, we definitely have to talk about those things as we continue to put together this team. You said it, there are holes on this team, but I would also say there will be people available going forward to fill those holes.
The Pats have been thought of as a lock to draft a quarterback 3rd overall, but now we're hearing Mayo and they're exploring all options. You know, we have to remember that Gerard Mayo is cut. He's not, this is the post-Belichick era. He can come and he can rage against the machine, and I hope he does. But we have Gronk on our show every week. I'm going to bring Hamilton here for a second, if he's around. Hamilton, it is worth noting quickly that, we're not going to know what to make of this Gerard Mayo era for a long time. We're not going to know. We shouldn't judge it. We should just sort of like take notes of it as we go on. But it is hard. It is hard to get out of what has been conditioned in you from your NFL birth, right? So like Gerard Mayo is very much one of those guys. Nink is one of those guys. Rob Gronkowski is one of those guys. Rob comes on our show, and how often have you heard him say in the two seasons, the two NFL seasons that he spent coming on our show, where he's allowed to open up, be himself, that he's like, oh, I think I still got that, like, Belichick answer stuff in me. How often have you heard him say that?
All the time. Yeah.
So I feel like with Mayo, I don't know, like, I'm not going to sit here and, like, decipher what he says, because I think some of that PTSD Belichickian, like, we don't know, maybe we'll do this, maybe we'll do that, still exists. But, I mean, it's sort of a womp fest right now, because there's holes to fill, and I don't know, like, now are they not going to get a quarterback? Are they going to trade back? Is that the move?
It could be. I could definitely see it happening, and it is interesting to see. You talk about Jerod Mayo's approach with the media so far. It seems like he is trying to break out of it a little bit, like him saying that they're going to burn cash in free agency. You know, I think he said during that press conference that he didn't regret it, but it did teach him a little bit about how to approach things.
Yeah.
It does seem like he is trying to be a little bit more open. And I think that, you know, it is a legitimate possibility that they could move that number three pick.
If you're a rookie, if you're one of these draft prospects at the quarterback position, are you like, Pats? And now the Pats are on the clock. Are you like, God damn, please, no, God, please.
It's at that point. It's crazy to think we're at that point, but I think it is when you look at what's going on with that roster right now.
Let's take a look, guys, as we have Hamilton here. I mean, their O-line's a disaster. They don't have a number one wide receiver on the roster. If you're a draft prospect at the quarterback position, you're like, man, Calvin Ridley, that would have been nice. No, but like, this is Justin Fields in Chicago part two. This team isn't anywhere near close to contending. Granted, they have to take a court, I think, or figure that out. But do you want to start the clock on that rookie contract when you have so many needs? Hamilton, this is a lot of needs here. But we're looking at their picks. What do you think?
Yeah, and that's really the concern is, as you mentioned, starting the clock on that rookie contract, what we just saw the Bears go through with Fields, right? They finally got the support around him, and now his contract is at a point where you haven't seen what he's fully capable of because they hadn't had the support, and now you're at a point where you have to decide whether or not you're going to pay him, and you don't even know what he fully is. It's a bad spot to be in. So the thought is, you know, do you build up the rest of that roster first, trade down, accumulate some more picks, accumulate some more talent, and then bring in the rookie quarterback later? It's a hard sell to fans, I think.
Yeah.
But it's an interesting idea.
And I think, like, you have to look at, like, when we sat with Coach Sean Payton at the Super Bowl, and he's like, I'm looking to fall in love. Like, if they're in love with a guy, fine. If you're not in love with a guy, then you do say, hey, Vikings, Broncos, who I'm sure want to, outside of that top 10, move in and get a quarterback. And, like, maybe the Patriots can then kick the quarterback down the road for one more season and save themselves that rookie window. It's kind of weird, but it's fascinating to see as they're rebuilding and getting it where it needs to be. What do you guys think at Up and Adam Show? We also wanted to give a little shout-out to the Rams here in the morning. Got Yogi Roth on the show, Javon Foster, a Mizzou guy who I'm sure Hamilton's excited about. But I do want to talk about the Rams because the Rams made a late free agency splash yesterday. Hamilton and I texted about it in between texts about, oh my gosh, Hamilton, help me. The haircut. Whose haircut did I send you?
Oh, Dan Campbell.
Dan Campbell's hair. Dan Campbell's haircut is a wow for me. We'll get into that tomorrow, of course, on the show. But the Rams, they add Bills All-Pro corner to Tre'Davious White. And it's always fascinating. And Hamilton and I are like, are the Rams good? Were they better? You know, they impressed us so much last year. What McVay was, I saw them, they were in Vegas. They were all sitting courtside for Nadal and Alcaraz. And they're all so close. And there's this thing. And now White's there on a one-year deal. Interesting offseason, as it always is. Then they retire Aaron Donald. Can they do this? Can they, you know, how can you replace that kind of a guy? They revamped their secondary. They land Lions Pro Bowl guard Jonah Jackson. They help the O-line. Even without Donald, there's a lot of talent across the board. And then always around draft time, it's like, what is this going to look like? And here's a reminder, guys, as you take a look at all the talent here. L.A. won of seven of their last eight to end the regular season. Best record in the league over that span. One loss was the overtime thriller against the Ravens with that punt return touchdown. I don't think that team we saw down the stretch was going to magically disappear, okay? I think they're going to pick up and do their thing. McVay, new dad, he's now got it figured out now. Maybe he's sleeping a little bit more over the offseason. Like, I don't know. I think he's found something. This is a nice little group here. The big four on the offense, Stafford, Kupp, Puka, Kyren, who we put, we love Kyren, of course. I mean, I feel like they stack up against anybody. The real team, we don't know what the heck the Seahawks are doing. This team I'm into. The roster's in good shape, and it has a chance to get a lot better. When I talk about the draft, they've got 11 picks in this year's draft. And supposedly, this is the first time in Sean McVay's 8 seasons that they will be making a first-round pick. They pick 19th overall this year. Hard to imagine they don't use it on the defensive front when they lose Donald. Whatever route they go, I mean, McVay and Snead, they get Puka, they get Kyren. Like, I'm just fascinated with what they do probably. I don't even want to see their first-rounder. But I did hear something very funny, Hamilton, you can wrap it up here for me, about didn't they ask Andrew Whitworth to come out and do the first-rounder or second-rounder? What do they do?
Yeah, they asked Whitworth to come to Detroit to announce the Rams' second-round pick, and he told Les Snead, he's like, I'm not doing it. I have no faith that you're actually going to stick with that pick and stay there, and I might just fly to Detroit for nothing, so I'd rather just pass and not go at all.
Amazing. Okay, we're going to take a short break here. I mean, we'll see. We'll see if McVay trades back. Whatever they do, I'm fascinated. I'm all in on Les Snead. They just make everything more fun because I like the zigging and zagging that they do. Okay, we've got lots to get to. Javon Foster on the show, Yogi Roth on the show. We're going to do one thing about somewhere in between there. We're going to talk a little NFL. We're going to get some prospects. And we're here. Yogi Roth's in studio. Next. I feel like it was long and, yeah, I guess, I don't know. I didn't want to do it. So I guess we could do it to start this block. Or we could do it, yeah, let's do it in the D maybe. Or like, yeah. I just feel like, hi! I feel like that. Can I get up? Oh my gosh, I'm not. No, 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 I'm good. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Come here. Oh, Phoebe. Hi. We are live on YouTube, just so you know.
I heard.
Richard's yelling at me. Make sure he knows. What do you think Yogi's going to say? He's going to incriminate himself or something? You never know. What's going on? We have your thing. Oh, do we not have that in the shot? Where is that? Oh.
Oh, look
Cat.
At that.
Can you grab that?
Oh, there it is.
No. It doesn't show in the shot because of this.
This is so cool.
What's
so
going on? Really?
Here. Yeah, dude. Last time I was here was none of this.
Really?
Yeah.
I think so. Yeah, I want it. We had the book. I think did I take it home?
I think a staffer took it. Yeah,
you probably read it before. You probably read it.
Took it. Eric, I like. Listen, I want to talk about Caleb.
Yeah, I want to talk about Eric.
What is the story with this Caleb? I mean, I'm just being from Chicago. I'm seeing like, it's almost like Chicago's problem. Chicago has some sort of like PTSD relationship thing where they're like not ready to. Except
who makes the decision there?
What do you mean?
The new president? Is the GM? Is the head coach?
I think polls. I think they trust polls. You don't think so?
I don't know. I don't.
As Yogi Roth is.
Why isn't it done? I mean, this should just be one of those where there's just a wrap. We know.
I don't.
Yeah, there's a lot of good stuff to talk about.
I don't know.
We'll go anywhere.
I remember a couple of years ago when I thought it was Sam Darnold. I was hearing like since Sam Darnold was 8 years old that he was going to go number one overall. Remember that?
Sam's gonna kill it.
You think so?
Mm-hmm.
I'm excited to talk about that. We had Kyle Rudolph on our show.
I read that. I saw that.
And he was like, rookie schmookie. Like, nobody can pick up what Kevin does volume wise.
Yeah.
It's too much.
Yeah, it'll be good. Especially last year with Kyle.
Yeah, yeah. He knows.
How's life?
Oh my God. Not great. I can't wait to talk to you. I can't wait. I need a coffee and a martini.
Pick a spot.
Yeah, yeah. What's around here?
I don't know. I'll figure it out.
Okay. Or we could go down to
Cinque.
We could do that.
All right. I'll figure it out.
That's like your favorite spot.
It's easy.
We could do that. I actually had a big meeting there like a couple weeks ago a month ago, and I was like, oh my God. I thought I was hoping I'd see you so I'd look cool.
But
you weren't there. Awesome. Where does this go?
Okay.
Oh. Here we go. We're joined by the author of it. I don't have the book because it's actually at home because I actually read it and look at it, and it's amazing. It's called 5-Star Quarterback. This is a quarterback guru, people, and a producer of Elite 11 docuseries, and currently the host of the It Factory podcast and owner of like a Paris football team.
We got to get you there.
What don't
we
gotta
do? We got to get you there.
When am I going, Yogi Roth?
You pick the home game. June, July, it's an Olympic year. You probably got some gig over there in the Olympics.
Are you... going to be in Perry?
Oh, yeah.
For
oh,
how
yeah.
long?
We're working through that, you know. Two kids.
I was gonna
is
say.
It just wife and I? I don't know. It's on me to present the options.
When does this start? Let's talk about this.
Yeah, so,
tell me all about this.
The European League of Football. Okay. We all grew up with NFL Europe, and then it fell apart. But everybody's kept playing in the communities, whether you're in Germany, whether you're in France, whether you're in Austria, you name it, everybody kept playing. And then a couple years ago, they're like, well, let's start a league and make it kind of the Premier League in Europe. So it's the European League of Football. It is the Premier League. They went from 14 teams a couple years ago. They added a few. Paris was one of them. And a good friend of mine, Jason Johnson, played quarterback at the University of Arizona, a little bit in the NFL, CFL. Anyway, he called along with some of the other guys on the ownership group. And they just said, hey, you want to be part of this thing? And I said, yeah, tell me about it. And on your roster, you have 40 that are from your home country, which is France for us, which is the obvious, the inverse of what NFL Europe was. It was most players were from the U.S. Then you get a handful from Europe, and then you get four from the U.S. And what I love doing is placing guys from the U.S. and helping our staff find these gems that, okay, their NFL dream ended. And as you know this, and we're all huge fans, like the mental health element of the game is identity is who am I, what am I, how am I going to figure life out? And it's like, what if you had a graceful goodbye to this game? And Kyle Sweet was one of our key Americans last year, played, he was with the Rams for a minute.
Yeah.
It was COVID. His dad died. He was trying to figure out his own life. And we said, hey, come play for our team. Became an all-conference player, had a blast, and just got to experience a summer in Europe.
And it's the Paris Musketeers.
It's the Paris Musketeers. Musketeers.
I need gears.
Oh,
I need
gear. I had gear on, but I was like, all right,
I need gear.
But I'll send you some gear.
Is this the team by any chance that, like, Tyreek Hill
smoked? It is the team.
How did you let this happen? Are you joking?
No,
let's take a look at this. This is Tyreek Hill, the Paris Musketeers, Darius Butler laughing because these DBs can't handle Tyreek.
But let me just be, number one, how about the opportunity for our guys to go line up and go do that?
How did
that
happen? Really
cool. He came over, he had a speed camp. And that's our stadium, by the way. Look at that beautiful stadium. That's where we play our
game. It is gorgeous.
And it gets packed. Fan base is off the hook. And look, I think for our guys, like, they were, number one, excited to do it. And number two, like, a lot of the guys that play on our team, they love football, but they also have 9-to-5s. Like, it's a really unique experience. Some of them also find their way and have gone to the NFL, gone to the XFL. Like, it's a cool blend of some guys who just love football and they're in their early 30s, and some are early 20s and have a dream to make it to the NFL or make it to the XFL. So it's a really cool combination. We just finished, like, our OTAs. Like, we have that as well, which is pretty cool.
So is it
like,
just totally the same? So, like, when we changed the kickoff rule, did they?
It's already done. We're ahead of the game.
Really?
Yes,
you already have the XFL rules?
Come watch it. We have the ELF rules, the European League of Football rules, and then everybody else watched and said, yeah, that makes a ton of sense.
Do you have a mascot?
We have.
Then I'm in, the internet knows.
We have
a
mascot, we have a dance
team. I
will
be there.
We have flags, we have chants. I went to the first home game last year, and they were doing chants. And I stood outside, because, you know, I'm just into the people. And I'm like, what made you drive 3 hours here? Why are thousands of people lining up?
I could just see
you
back there.
No mic, just kind
of
hanging out, man, on the street.
Yes,
totally. And they were like, we love football.
We have to get, do you have a water? Okay, good.
Yeah, and that's the thing. They love football. And football is a global game. I think the NFL just announced.
Do you have one in Poland?
Call me when
there's a Poland team.
And then
I could definitely do that. I'll buy into that ownership group. Yeah. Okay, 5-star quarterback. This is back in 2020, Caleb Williams, USC stud, probably number one overall, and J.J.
McCarthy.
Right
in the middle right there, right near your finger, right there in the middle.
Where is he?
Right there, go left a little bit.
I don't see him.
Up.
Okay,
there.
Got it. Okay, so they're all here, and they were part of the Elite 11 class of 2020.
Yep.
You wrote about them back in 2022, or before that, when this book was published back then. How did you sort of know that, or did you know that these two would be standouts as far as their next 2 years?
Yeah, I think when I look back on almost 20 years at the Elite 11, certain players have always stood out. It's very few and far between. Jameis Winston, first year I saw him, I was like, this guy's different. You could just tell. And his career was that. Trevor Lawrence was the same way. Tua had this infectious it factor to him that was just different. We've talked about that before in the past. I felt even Justin Fields had it from an acumen standpoint. Like, he was so obsessed with the craft. Caleb was the same way. Like, you knew Caleb even as a sophomore in high school. Like, hey, who's this guy? His plan is a little different. And then he got there, and it was a pandemic Elite 11 year. And he was incredibly friendly with everybody, but he also came to win. Like, he had a different mindset to him that you could just feel. And guys came out of that Elite 11 that summer and said, whoa, something's different. And it's fun when you dive into the book about him and he talks about, like, whether it's a letter to his younger self or how he projected the game moving forward coming out of high school or even just being in junior high. Like, from jump, he's had a plan. And his lane has always been about the game. And I think what's, you know, part of the deal when you're the number one pick is that everything outside of the game gets picked apart. What you wear, what you drive, what basketball game you're at, like, you name it, it gets picked apart. And for him, I was at his pro day the other day, and I was talking to people in his circle, and I'm like, he's never gotten in trouble once.
What's
off
his
the
circle?
Field.
Tell me his circle. He doesn't have an agent, so that's unconventional.
He's got
that's
a management
different.
Team.
Okay, so
yeah,
he's
the same
got,
people
he's got
have
a
been
team.
Around
okay,
him. Great. I mean, let's just be blunt. Caleb Williams is a true one percenter, and by that, he's the first NIL quarterback in the history of the transfer portal to truly be in a major market, in the biggest market in college football. So to deal with that and to operate at the level he did and win a Heisman, it's just never been done before.
Yeah.
So I think
NFL, get used to it, and fan bases, get used to it.
Yeah, that's what it's going to be moving forward. And I think for Caleb, everything he's done has been, you know, a lot of times for the first time, you know, transferring to LA, NIL, huge deals, other players in the NIL community or in the transfer world coming because of him. I mean, he's been this magnet from jump, and it got put on a grand stage when he got here in LA.
What did you see at his pro day?
I mean, I've done this long enough to know that these guys should complete every pass. I mean, wow, you know, like they're the wow throws, but he's done them with shoulder pads on. He's done them in real games. I didn't see anything that surprised me, shocked me. It was, yes, he's going to deal.
Another day at the
office. It's another day at the office. He lives for this. I think the thing that doesn't get enough play and did at the combine was, oh my gosh, he was the last guy standing on the practice field. Every practice I've gone to as an analyst at USC, I've called numerous of his games. He's always the last guy. And it's not because he's trying to hit the goalpost and get extra drill work in. It's because he wants to hang with the fellas. And I learned this from Tom Brady probably 15 years ago. I read an article. I give it to every high school quarterback now, which is you are either an extension of the staff or an extension of the huddle. And Brady goes, no, I'm extension of the huddle. Caleb's the same way. And I love that lens of the world of, like, I'm extension of the fellas. I'm not just an extension of the staff. And I think there's a difference there, especially in the NIL world or number one draft pick world. Like, you have to pour yourself into the teammates versus what the franchise says you are, what the staff says you are. And he's unique there. I mean, he's as personal of a teammate as you're going to find. He's going to have no problem assimilating if he is the number one pick. I think we all project him to be that at Chicago. And he'll do exactly what he's done. If he has the right system around him, he'll kill it.
He's got Keenan there. Like, I'd be excited to see that, of course. Like, DC could make some crazy move if Chicago isn't, for some reason, in love with him. Why? So if all of this is true, and he's dealing, and he's this one of the fellas, why is he polarizing? Why?
Well, nobody's done what he's done. Name another college athlete that went to Milan and walked on the runway prior to a college football season. Mm-hmm. Like, name another college player that's got multi-million dollar NIL deals. Like, name another college player, X, Y. Like, you just keep going.
Will it affect him knowing him? Because it's like a lot. It's a lot.
I think he's still...
He went to a game and he had a pink phone case, which he's had, I'm sure, for... I don't even know why that's a thing or what that says. I don't want to get into that, really. But, like, he can't do anything.
Yeah.
He can't do anything without weird stuff happening.
Yeah. Well, I think there's two sides to it. One, he's got the ability to block things out because that's the world he's in. Two, he is a human. And I think that gets lost. It's why we wrote the book, is so many players don't meet other people's expectations. He may not meet the expectations of a number one pick. Like, we could have the debate, did Jameis meet the expectation of our number one pick? I don't know, right? Like, no. Like, what does that even mean? What is the expectation? Did Jared Goff meet the expectation of our number one pick? Took a team to the Super Bowl, and then they said, hey, we want somebody else. Took that team to the NFC Championship.
I'm more confused. I'm just confused about... Like, I do this temperature check with Chicago, and I'm like, Justin Fields, they're like, don't get rid of Justin Fields. Yeah. And I'm like, wait, but what? And then they don't want Caleb. And then it's like, then I said the Commanders could trade up, and then Chicago was like, shut up. Like, I don't understand where any of that comes from. It almost feels like to me a little bit like Chicago's not ready for him. Like, they're not ready to have this caliber of a player or something.
They're used
to, like, the 35 years of everything else. I don't know. But It's weird. It's I don't like it. I don't like it.
I feel like every radio show in Chicago talking about this exact subject.
Chicago's wild.
Reasons. Yeah. And to me, it just makes the most sense. You got the number one pick. He got a chance to be a transformational player. what he does, you know, it's all the terms, right? The off platform, off schedule, mm-hmm. like, is special. He also can play within the pocket, and that will be the challenge, of course, in the NFL. But he's proven to do it. I mean, they had drills at SC where they'd have a whole period where he'd just have to sit in the pocket. You're not allowed to get out of it just to drill that. And he's still young. He's still going to be his third year ever as a full-time starter will be as a rookie in the NFL. And every rookie, I can remember when various first-rounders told me this. Sam Darnold told me this. He said the hardest year is your rookie year because you go from big bowl game. Or, you know, Caleb didn't have a bowl game, but he had all the dialogue around him in the draft. He's going to come out, et cetera. To combine, pro day, interviews, mini camp, OTAs, training camp. And then your season's twice as long, potentially, as college. And, like, they all hit a wall. Like, it's just a hard season that first year. So he won't be everything that Chicago dreams of him to be today if he goes there. But he's going to be, he can be a cornerstone of this thing. And this thing can flip. You saw it with Justin Fields. Like, he was going to be the cornerstone of it. So they have to make a decision. And I just hope this, because we've seen it so many times, if you don't have everything around you, having Keenan Allen's great. But if you're front office, if you're offensive line, if you're position coach, if you're assistant quarterback coach, like if everything isn't in place, look at Russ when he went to Pete and the Seahawks. I mean, it was so beautifully set up for his success. I don't know what that is like intimately in Chicago.
And now we've got Russ and Justin duking it out to be quarterback in Pittsburgh. We're talking about that a little bit later when I get to some of these other quarterback draft prospects. I haven't met any of them. So you've got Caleb, let's say, one to Chicago. Then you've got the Commanders. They're at two, likely to take J.J. McCarthy. What do I need to know about him?
He's another special guy. To have those two in the same class, J.J.'s got a way about him that is beautiful. You're around this guy, and he's got a presence that will just calm everything, and he's got a competitive temperament that will elevate everything. And he's got a way to kind of see clearly through it. I love him. You know, this is becoming vogue, but high school quarterbacks diving into mental skills. J.J. McCarthy has done that, right? It's well-documented, meditating prior to the pregame of any big-time game that he's ever played. But it's all the
other
work.
Did he get that from you, Yogi?
I don't know where he got that, but I do believe in this, that you can train three things. You can train your craft. You train your body, and you can train your mind. He understands and pours into all equally. And he's also had to operate a big-time playbook. He's had to operate in big circumstances. He's made huge throws. Like, you can nitpick what's he like in the red zone as the game gets tighter and faster. Well, welcome to the NFL. Every quarterback has to deal with that. But I'm excited for him. I think he's a pro's pro. I think he'll walk in, and in that environment, if he goes there, I'm the biggest Commander fan there is right now because of the coaching staff and what they've done with Dan Quinn and Cliff. My best friend in life, John Glenn, is their assistant special teams coordinator. Is my high school quarterback, Kay. So
yeah,
I'm all in on what they do next.
You're all in. Okay, so we know about those two. Is there somebody in this draft that you think you need to put on my map here?
Well,
go ahead.
Well, it's probably not your map, but I feel like every article I read, and I'm a huge Michael Penix Jr. fan, so I think he's on the map already. But Bo Nix, I feel like, has slid off the map a little bit.
Okay,
this is a guy over 60 starts, most starts in the history of college football. When you comp him to other players, like, it's just dramatic in terms of his experience. I look at him and, can he be Andy Dalton? Like, can he be that second round pick that thrives moving forward? He'll be a complete and utter pro. I mean, he's had a different offensive coordinator every year he's been in college. He's been in college for 6 years. Like, he's had a different system every single year he's had to be in college. He went through absolute, you can insert whatever word you want because my kids might be watching, but he went through absolute whatever when he was in Auburn. I mean, he went there to be a legacy player, got absolutely destroyed by that community because he didn't live up to the hype, goes out to Oregon because he wants to win a national championship, leads them to a Pac-12 championship, decides to come on back, gets married in the meantime. Like, he's just a pro. He's going to walk in and absolutely thrive. He won't have the hype that all these other guys have, but he won't need it.
He might be in a better position on a better team.
No doubt. I love Michael Penix's position because he's going to be able to walk. It's going to be it's going to truly be healthy. I don't know if it'll be Seattle. You know, we know we love the Seahawks.
Would you die? You'd be so excited about that.
Ryan Grubbs is OC. It'd be incredible.
I don't know. I was just talking about the Rams. I don't know what Seattle's doing.
Me neither.
Because I'm like, okay, well, Niners, fine. And then I'm like, okay, Rams, always. But it'll be interesting to see what they do in the draft. And then I'm like, kind of in on Arizona because everyone's sleeping on them. And I actually think that they, like, had a lot of injuries. And I think it's that they'll be okay and they really play well for their coach. And then I'm like, what is Seattle?
Yeah.
What is Seattle this year?
Well, John Schneider's always had it figured out. You know, like,
yeah.
you know, okay. Do they get rid of their picks? Do they trade? I mean, they'll do something.
Yeah.
But I think there's an opportunity for them to. This quarterback class is so rich. It's so deep. There's so much talent. Do they trade up to try to get somebody? They say, hey, no, we're good with where we sit today. We just got Sam Howell. We have our starter. Maybe
I do love Sam
all
Howell.
Is fine. Yeah.
Okay, I want to ask you. We're going to take a break here in a couple of minutes. Would you rather get to Joe Milton, Jaden Daniels, or Drake May?
Let's go Jaden Daniels.
Okay, Jaden, okay, tell me what you think here. His pro day
yeah.
is today.
Yeah, it's coming up.
It's in a couple of hours, so teams are worried, I know, about his weight a little bit. He's like sub 200.
Yeah.
Is that something that I need to be aware
of? I mean, he's
of?
Always been sub 200.
This feels like Bryce Young all over again.
Except he's like 6'3 and a half.
Okay, tell
you
me.
You know, he and Bryce are different body types, similar playing types. We talked about this last year, like point guard, Steph Curry-esque. I think for Jaden, every environment he's been in. Go to freshman year at Michigan State, fourth quarter drive, no problem. Then go to the last 2 years in the SEC, he carried this team, and he carried himself to a Heisman.
He was Elite 11, right? 2018.
He was Elite 11. 2018. Last year's counselors were even better. It was he, Caleb, I mean, Michael Penix Jr. It was awesome when those guys come on back and hang out. But Jaden Daniels, I've known these guys since they were 15, 16 years old. He's put on a bunch of weight. But most importantly, like, he's put on this maturity to himself. Because, again, you look at Michael Penix Jr., you look at Bo Nix, Caleb Williams, mm-hmm. and now, who we're talking about here, they've all transferred. Joe Milton, like, mm-hmm. you have to go through adversity. One of the top questions all GMs ask, I was talking to Jim Nagy at the Senior Bowl. Mm-hmm. said, do you have a consistent question you ask everybody? He said, yeah. Tell me about a moment you've gone through adversity. Same thing we ask every quarterback at 11 to write an essay about at 16. These guys have had real adversity because they've had to adjust and change. Jaden Daniels at Arizona State, that was a challenging environment in terms of how he left and when he left and the what the school was going through in terms of the NCAA. Mm-hmm. Then he found a home at LSU. Everybody thought, is he even gonna win the job? Won the job, beat Alabama in overtime, and then comes back and wins a Heisman the next year. And he can make every throw. He's dynamic with his legs. He knows when to not get hit. Like, the weight, the height, to me, every GM and coach, they have a blueprint. And they have a way in terms of they know what fits into their box. He's going to make somebody extremely happy. And he might. He might be the best out of all of them if he drops into the healthiest of environments and he can play in a clean pocket. If he's not running for his life, if he can run with purpose, if he can do that, I mean, look out.
What question does he have to answer today?
Nothing.
Really?
I mean, I don't think
Why even do Pro Day? Marvin Harrison Jr. has it right.
I love Pro Days, yeah. Not for Jaden Daniels and Caleb, but because they're the beacon. And I love, guys get a ton of slack for not throwing at the combine. And I could go either way on that. But you're bringing every eyeball to your pro day for the fifth round wide receiver, for the DB.
Sure.
I enjoy
that.
Okay,
you're the Commanders at 2. Are you taking J.J. McCarthy or are you taking Jaden Daniels?
I don't know. If I had to pick today.
Yeah. If you had to pick
today. I'm thinking
today.
Like weather. I'm going through like all those elements. Yeah. I'd probably lean towards J.J.
Towards JJ.
Yeah.
Too.
But then I think of Cliff and his system and who do I see dealing in that? You know, like if you just look at his history, Jayden. I think Jaden. Yeah. So I would go to the interview and I go back to the fit.
Yeah.
I can't help but think of all these guys that have been traded now. Like you look at Marcus Mariota, you look at Sam Darnold, go back to Josh Rosen as mm-hmm, a top 15 pick. Like you could argue none of their fits were really healthy. Jets, Arizona at the time.
Of course.
That's the deal. I think that's just the Justin saying, you can make these.
The scary part about it is that there's a very low hit rate on second stories.
Yeah.
Like you look at Sam Howell and it's like, I believe in you. I hope you thrive. I hope. But it's very rare. It's very rare to have a Kerry Collins. I don't even know. What are the other names? Geno Smith-ish. Yeah. No, not Geno. To take a team to a playoff the next year. It's very, the numbers are bad. The numbers are bad. So that's why the draft is so important. It's very hard to rewrite the Deshaun Kaiser story.
It's the same reason why we wrote the book.
Yeah.
54% of quarterbacks transfer.
Hamilton texted me the other names. I'm annoyed that I can't remember. I was looking at all of this of like the real success of rewrites.
Everybody's told their first round pick. And I think there's been 12 quarterbacks that were first round picks heading into last year's draft?
Yeah.
Like that were 5-star quarterbacks in high school? Like, so you're telling me like over 80% of them are just busts. You know, like it's the same thing in the whole discussion we're having here. Like in 2 years, out of these 5 quarterbacks we've talked about, how many of them are going to make it? or really be the guy? I don't know. Probably not all of them.
Yeah.
Because every year there's going to be a new five.
You got to get to a healthy place, a la Baker.
Yes. Look at that. Who would have predicted that?
Me, I love Baker.
Yeah, there you go. That's why you have this set in this show.
That's we're going to take a short break here. We are going to hang out with Yogi. We're going to talk a little. I want to know about Sam Darnold lighting it up. I want to know about, okay. I mean, Justin Herbert.
Oh, let's go.
I feel so bad for him. What do you mean, let's go? Where?
Oh, turn the page.
Oh, you think so?
Yes.
Who's he throwing the ball to? Okay, we've got Javon Foster. We're going to get to know him as well. All after this from my set because I know all the things. That's right, I called Baker. Now, I'm always here for a second story, but the numbers are bleak. They're bleak. Yeah. I'll show you a text from, yeah. Bleak.
It's even worse in college.
So they all have this, yeah. I mean, they all have adversity, huh?
I'm just going to adjust your mic.
Yeah. No problem. I think you're out for this one, and then you're coming back, my friend.
Wow.
If there's anything else, tell... Richard, can you come out and talk to Yogi if there's anything he wants to bump or move from the B block to the D block?
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's anything we want to move.
That is it.
Okay, so we got everything pretty much? Because we got Penix in there. And he went into the quarterback that he... Did you guys not get the name of the quarterback he was going to talk about under the radar so we could have something on him? That number 9 question, did we have B-roll for that? I know, but we didn't have any B-roll or anything. We had nothing.
Oh,
did he give you an answer on that?
No.
Oh, he didn't. I would have loved to, because since he was here, we knew to have something, like at least a picture of him.
Okay.
Eric, will you just see what I don't know how long that D-block's going to be.
I'll get the time on that. Okay.
Thank you. Okay, let's go, Javon. And how is Javon this morning? Tell me, control room. Where is he coming to me from? What part of our great world? No, shut up. Awesome! Cool. Okay. Hammy, was I right about Kerry Collins? That's one, right?
Let him know about 4.
Took his team to the playoffs. Right, Hammy?
Okay, yeah, that was, it was Kerry, it was Baker, and it was Ryan Tannehill was the other one.
Yeah.
To go from former first round pick, go to another team and take them to the playoffs.
Rough.
Yeah.
What do you think of Knicks? Good? We'll talk about them later.
Yeah. Right there.
Okay, dokey. Matthew Hamilton went to Mizzou. I went to Mizzou, and my next guest is a 3-year starter for Mizzou, a 2023 first-team All-SEC selection, a 2023 third-team All-American, and you took down your dad's Ohio State Buckeyes in the final game of your career with a 14-3 win in the Cotton Bowl. How much trash did you talk with your pops after that?
I talk a lot, man, because I know I got that bragging right for the rest of my life. So, you know, I try to always, you know, throw it in the conversation at the end of the conversation or just, you know, just throw it in his face a couple times. You
100.
Know, you deserve it.
I need, like, T-shirts made, just every time there's a family holiday, you should just always, just a little reminder, just a little something.
Yeah.
Now, you're in Columbia, Missouri. Are you going to miss those days a little bit? Are you feeling nostalgic, counting down clock going?
Yeah, I'm for sure miss Columbia a little bit. You know, I spent a lot of time here. You know, the fan base. You know, they just show so much support. You know, every time you know I'm even going out, you know, they always you know just helping me out and different things like that. So of course I'm gonna miss this. You know, this is always gonna be my second home.
Now you played. You're a very special player. You played left tackle in college. You can also play on the right. My eyebrows are up. Everybody gets excited about this. When you're talking to these coaches, these scouts, what are they telling you about your versatility? What are they asking you?
You know, they said a lot about my game. You know, like I said, I started off my career, you know, I started 3 games at right tackle, then I was moved to the left. So, you know, I played a lot of my career at the left tackle position. I have a lot of film there. So, you know, just for instance, like at the Senior Bowl, different things like that, I wanted to show that I can play right still, you know, and just try to show that I'm versatile, you know, and I can do a lot.
According to our friends at Pro Football Focus, they crank all the numbers, they keep tabs of everything, nothing goes unrecorded. You allowed 1 sack and 0 quarterback hits in 2023. How?
Yeah. Oh, man, you know, it's just honestly just a blessing from God. You know, I know that I worked hard, you know, extremely each day, day in and day out. You know, I got great coaches around me, you know, that helped me out. And anything that I needed, you know, I'm always came to them and they got a chance to give me feedback and different tips like that. So, you know, they just made my job a lot easier. And also I had a great quarterback in Brady Cook, you know, he's made my job, like I said, a lot easier too. So, you know, it was just a blessing.
Does that 1 sack haunt you?
Yeah, it for sure does.
Tell me about that.
I know. I felt like I could have, you know, I had a pretty good year, you know, just a clean year. But, you know, every game player get beat. So, you know, I'm not really that down on it. But, you know, I felt like I could have, you know, for sure had 0 sacks this year.
I think that's what coaches want to hear, that it haunts you a little bit. I think that's great. Let's take a look at some of this. Look at this Senior Bowl. This is practice. Look at this rep. 1.1 million views on Twitter, by the way. Why do you think this went so viral? What did you make of this?
I don't know. People just like to see physical, you know, physical line work. You know, I'm honestly used to that. You know, I have a great teammate like Darius Robinson that I used to go up against every day in practice. So, you know, different things like that. We used to always go at it. So I'm kind of used to that type of thing.
The guy you're blocking there looks so frustrated. I want to see that again. Can we see that again? He looks so mad, Javon. He's like, what? It's amazing. Yeah. Darius Robinson, what can you tell me about him?
Man, he's a great player. You know, he's an extreme hard worker. You know, like I said, I used to stay out to practice each day, you know, for about 20 minutes, getting extra work in and different things like that. And I would always look over and see Darius Robinson doing the same thing. So I knew that he was just bound to have a great year. You know, he changed from, you know, D-tackle to the end. And I always knew he had the ability to do that. So, you know, I just put a lot of trust in him because I knew he worked for it. And, you know, he finally showed everybody what he can do.
And you're both Detroit guys. You're both Mizzou guys. I'm excited for both of you. And you're this expert in one-on-one drills. So I thought we could get to know you a little bit. We're going to throw a couple things your way. You tell me who would win one-on-one. We're calling it Javon on one. You up against Mizzou teammate, fellow Detroit guy, Darius Robinson, one-on-one. Who wins?
D-Rob, no, I love him, but I'm going to have to go with me, myself.
How about Crocs or slides? I hear you like, you're quite a fan of Crocs.
Yeah, I'm a huge Croc dude. It started off in high school. Like, my dad, he honestly put me onto the Crocs, you know, very young. So, I'm going to have to go with Crocs.
How many Crocs do you have?
I don't even, I got them scattered all over the house. I know I have a few pair of my mom's. I got a few pair of my dad's. So I couldn't even tell
like
you.
Like 20 pairs or less than 20?
Maybe I'll say probably less than 20. Maybe around like 12 to 15.
St. Louis pizza, which I can't even believe people call it pizza. Or Detroit pizza, one-on-one. Who wins?
For sure, Detroit pizza. I'm sorry. But I grew up eating Detroit pizza my whole life, so I'm going to have to go with Detroit pizza.
It's my favorite kind of pizza, actually. And people who think like that emo stuff, get out of here with that. Is El Rancho still in Colombia?
Yes.
El Rancho or Shakespeare's Pizza, one-on-one?
Oh, I'm going to have to go with El Rancho. So I'm a big fan of Mexican food. So I kind of like El Rancho.
I feel like you saying El Rancho means you're a big fan of partying, because El Rancho is what you eat at 2 in the morning, and Shakespeare's what you can have like in the middle of the day. So I see what you're saying, and I like that.
El Rancho, it's really a spot called El Magüey that I really go to.
I love El Magüey.
Yeah, El Magüey is my spot. Yeah, I honestly like that more.
I used to F up some El Magüey back in my day. I love that. Is Trop still there? Is Trop still a thing in Colombia?
I believe so.
That's right. Don't admit to knowing. Exactly. Yes. Yeah. I believe so is great. How about My producer who went to Mizzou goes, you know he's a real one with the El Rancho answer. And I said, yes, yes, yes. Yeah. Your head coach, Coach Drink, or your O-line coach, Brandon Jones? One-on-one, who wins?
One-on-one? Hey, why do you have to put me in that position? I don't know.
I'm not sure. You've got to answer tough questions like this. Come on now.
Yeah.
Drink or Jones?
I would go Jones.
Jones.
I would go Jones. Yeah, like I'll just that. Go Jones. Yeah, I don't like that answer, but I had to go Jones.
Yeah, I made you answer. That's what you say. That mean K made me answer. Number 24, Kobe, or number 8, Kobe?
24. I would say 24. He had a different mindset. You know, he was that was also my favorite player. But yeah, 24, Kobe had a different mindset, and he was just honestly a killer.
What was that mindset? Why was it different?
For him, you know, I felt like young Kobe was just a lot of just going out there and just, you know, just putting up numbers and different things like that. I felt like 24 Kobe had a different mission and wanted to really win, you know, try to bring his team along and different things like that.
What's your mission? What is your mentality as you head towards the draft and towards the next level of your career?
My mentality is, you know, I'm a physical, dominant offensive lineman. So, you know, I love to compete, so it don't matter who I'm going up against. You know, I go up against the best, honestly, in the SEC, and I'm ready to, you know, just go up against the best in the league. So my mentality is I'm always going to try to dominate and always win everything.
6 years as a Tiger, 3 years starting. You did choose to sort of use your sixth year of eligibility, and you stunned in your senior season. What happened? What do you think evolved the most about your game over those 6 seasons in Como?
For me, I think it was just maturing as a player. You know, I honestly started off my football career kind of late, you know, starting off my junior year of high school when I first started playing. So, you know, just me maturing as a football player, you know, just getting used to the terminology and just me making sure my technique is sharp and different things like that is honestly why I needed the extra year. But, you know, I always knew Mizzou had the talent. I felt like we could never put it all together. So I felt like this year, us captains, we did a great job, you know, delivering a message to the team, and they all came along together.
Javon, you said that your grandmother and your mom, you said this at the combine, that they're sort of your why. They're your mentality, your motivator, too. I know your grandmother passed away. May she rest in peace. And I know she's proud of you looking down. Your mom is a mail carrier in Detroit, where you're from. She worked hard as hell to see you and get you where you are today. Is that where your toughness comes from?
Yeah, for sure. You know, just going back to my mom, she, you know how the snow can get in Detroit. It can be up to your knees, but she's still going out there trying to deliver mail and different things like that. I know she's a very tough lady. She never complained and different things like that. But, you know, I also get a little bit from my dad. You know, he played a little bit in the league and had his time. So, you know, I got a little bit from him, too, I would say.
Last one for you. I want to take a look at this. We dug this one up from your signing day in high school. Just to see your sort of thoughts here. Where does this take you? Look at that bow tie, by the way. What do you think when you see this?
Man, this is it was a great moment for me. You know, I never thought I'd get the opportunity, you know, just to play college football, but even in the SEC. So, you know, just me going back, I was just super happy and excited just to be in that position. You know, hopefully I was just trying to make my family proud, and I know they were just excited for me, too.
I know you like Tyron Smith. You model your game after him.
Yes.
Joe Thomas, Trent Cole. Mm-hmm. Let's get you on one of these teams in the NFL and put you in those ranks. I'm really looking forward to it. You're awesome. Javon Foster, I don't know if your family's watching. Shout out to your mom. Shout out to everybody. Yeah. And enjoy. I mean, it's all happening in your hometown. And by the way, I noticed how quickly you said you would beat Darius one-on-one, but you couldn't decide on anything else that quickly. So, like, you really would put the smoke on Darius Robinson. That's what I learned today.
Darius know I love him. You know, I was his host on this vision, so he knows it's all love.
Okay. You did. We dug so deep into your Twitter, Javon, that we saw that you liked the Ravens. I'm just saying. I've seen you tweet about the Ravens, Javon.
Okay. That was probably so long ago, but yeah, I might have.
Listen, sometimes the universe takes things full circle. We'll see where you end up. Good luck to you. Enjoy every minute. Javon Foster coming to us from Columbia, Missouri. He prefers El Magway. That's actually a lot. You know, all these losers going to El Rancho, waiting in line. He's going, he sees himself in a different way. A little elevated fare. All right, we'll be back. I'm talking Sam Darnold and company after this. Yogi! Get back out here, Yogi. I know. El Magway. Hamilton, I have not heard about El Magway in a long time.
That's the intro, and then I think we got 2, 3, 4. Just with the time we have.
We're back with, okay. So we talk a little bit of Bryce Young?
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'd love to. Okay. Dick and Alice, too. That day when he was like 21.
What?
Dave took my job when I left coaching. So he was always around us when I was there.
Let's just get into this right now. Are we ready, guys, back there? Okay, we're going to start on YouTube. It'll go into beats. It's fine. Okay. Elite 11 fame. Over 20 years is crazy. It does sound weird to say.
I know. I feel old. Oh, like, it's brutal. And you
got five-star quarterback guys. We're talking all these quarterback prospects. You got your J.J. McCarthy's, your Caleb Williams. All the guys are in here. But there's a bunch of guys who went through your ranks, through your hands, through your, you know, motivational tactics that you're handing those Tom Brady articles to, that are in the NFL right now in really interesting positions. Yes. I want to talk a little bit about Bryce Young. You know Coach Dave. I met Coach Dave, and I was like, oh, I get it.
Yeah.
I get it. I get the vibes and all of that. I want you to hear what he said when we caught up with him in Carolina.
One of the first things I mentioned about Bryce is when you watch him play in college football and you saw him in those big games on TV, whether it was early in the season or whether it was later in the season against really good opponents, if you look behind the face mask, the eyes are the same. His countenance is the same. And he's just cold-blooded. And so those things were what really, you know, encouraged me to say this is going to be the top guy coming out because he's the guy. He is him. Is that what people say nowadays?
He is him. He is him. He said he's cold-blooded. I'm looking at how many times he was sacked. That was I was like, I have his sack numbers here and the 100, I think 11 or 12 hits that he absorbed and then went back out there and was fine. What do you make of Bryce Young in 2024 with your boy Dave?
I think that let's just say that was how Bryce Young grew up in a family. You've documented his dad was in the book. They understand mental skills. I go back to that again of like, how do you deal with being the number one pick? How do you deal with leaving California to go to Alabama? How do you deal with not having the year that you hope to have? How do you deal with your boy you played with, C.J. Stroud, growing up, becoming that guy in his rookie year? Like, how do you deal with that? And then your coach is fired midseason. How do you deal with that? And I just think emotional intelligence is defined as having the capacity to deal with your thoughts and the thoughts of others with empathy. That is Bryce Young. He's got capacity. And when Coach Canales talks about how he has that, or he says he's cold-blooded or whatever it may be, he's talking about that, his capacity, his bounce-back capacity. You reference the sack numbers. You got to get back up after you get hit.
I think.
You have to look at this offensive line. You have to wear the C on your jersey. Like, you have to get back to the facility. Bryce never flinched. And he's also human, and I'm sure it was a really challenging year for a lot of reasons. And what Dave Canales will do, if he has not already done it, he's going to breathe life into that facility and, most importantly, that quarterback room. And I say that when guys go to their second or third place, whether it's right now we're going to talk about Sam Darnold, we talk about Jared Goff, like all those guys, when I've talked to them after that, they're like, God, it's amazing to sit across from a coach that is breathing life into me.
Yeah.
When I need that, I need some of this oxygen right now because every cornerback, I've always felt like it is a very sensitive position. They're as self-conscious as any person in entertainment. I mean, what somebody says about them, what people think about them. And it makes sense. Every throw is judged their whole life. How'd I do, coach? How'd I do, coach? Every rep, how'd I do on the handoff? How was my footwork? Everything is evaluated. So I look to Bryce and Dave. It is going to be, I think, a beautiful marriage. And I think Dave Canales is the next gen of coaches in the NFL. I always wanted to go to college just to be around him more in my
daily
craft.
Why didn't he make him the OC?
Good question. I've wondered that. I've talked to Pete about that. I don't know. But I know this. That
I think it's his why.
Yeah. Maybe.
I think it is his. No, I think it's Dave's. I think Dave is, that's on his plate of like, I want to kick ass.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure that he got looked over, what, like twice for that gig?
Yeah.
I imagine.
I don't know. I would. I've known Dave for 20 years.
Yeah.
I don't think Dave is driven by what he didn't get.
Mm.
I really don't. I think this is a. Again, I don't want to be repetitive on the mental skills thing, but I think if you polled players this year at the combine or the draft, they would not say, I'm proving everybody wrong, proving the haters wrong. They say, I'm going to prove myself right. Like, the vernacular has changed. And I think Dave's the same way. He's taken all the great things that he learned from Pete.
Yeah.
And he's going to utilize them in the role that he's in now. And so much of that at times, and you know this, but for those that are watching, when you're making those hires as an OC or a quarterback coach, whatever, mm-hmm. especially those big ones with high-pressure stakes in the NFL, so much is about what you think as the head coach the organization needs. Do we need somebody with tremendous run game acumen? Do we need somebody who had this experience with the Rams, for instance?
Like, I get it.
So much, I lived that when I was coaching at SC, where I was like, how did I not get this job? And he was like, well, we needed Jeremy Bates because the run game at the time. Mm-hmm. And I remember I was so pissed. It was part of me that left coaching. So like, this is BS at the time. But it makes sense when you mature and you look at it from that lens. So I don't think Dave is going to say, oh, I'm going to prove that guy anything.
Fields.
Let's go.
It's the last one. We only have 2 minutes left. Talk to me. He was with you in Elite 11
Huge
World.
Huge fan. On the
2017.
Table
didn't timing is a thing. Situation's a thing. It didn't work out for him. What do you make of him in 2024?
I'm excited for him to just take a breath. I can go back to what I referenced earlier about quarterbacks when their year is over and they declare for the draft, they never really get to take a breath. Mm-hmm. I doubt Justin Fields got to take a breath. Even when he tried to and just go on vacation and like unfollowed people on Instagram, he got lit up. Like,
what do we get wrong about him?
Well, I just think that the expectation is what's wrong. And then the fit obviously didn't work when it was there, but the expectation.
The expectation is what's wrong, Church of Yogi.
But the expectation is also what drives people to buy jerseys, drives people to go to games, it drives the fandom of the game, it drives it to be a global sport. Like, the expectations are part of the job. So you're not going to eliminate them, and the players have to continue to find ways to manage and deal with them. But for him, he didn't meet everybody else's expectation. Probably didn't meet his, and I'm sure there's a million reasons why. I love that he gets to take a breath.
Justin Herbert, Jared Goff, or who was the other one I was looking? Or Sam Darnold, who has the top five season?
Jared Goff.
Jared Goff out of those three.
I think Jared Goff has a chance to win the MVP, takes his team to Super Bowl.
What?
I've been around Jared Goff, and I think that where he sits now, the comfort in his own feet and who he is and the way he's played and what he did last year and what this team believes in moving forward, like, I am all in on the Rams. Jared Goff.
Jared Goff's with Detroit.
And
you
look
mean
what
Detroit
did last
year.
Yeah.
I'm all in on the Rams, too, but they obviously have Stafford and company, and they've got... But you think Jared Goff can lead Detroit to a Super Bowl?
Yeah.
I mean, they met every expectation last year. I don't see why they couldn't.
Exceeded.
Yeah.
Every
expectation. I think they were pretty hyped, but we'll see what they do. I mean, the draft's in their backyard, so we'll see what they do. Yogi Roth, we love you. 5-star quarterback, guys. Go pick it up and subscribe to the It Factory podcast, which I've not been a guest on, which is weird.
Don't worry. Okay. There's just a movie.
Bye, guys. We'll see you tomorrow.